down. My grandfather got a letter, and he couldn't read it. He took it to his parish priest. This is as I get the story now. And he said, well, you can't read it because it's in Russian. You're just about to get drafted. Okay, so he left. And I'm not sure how he got to the United States or whatever, but that's how he got here. Okay, on my mother's side, her maiden name was Kochalski. They came from near, I can't remember. But they came through Liverpool and landed in Connecticut. So I have a good Polish family. I'm here and I have notes here. And I wish I was as good as that guy yesterday who spoke. But I have some notes because I have to have some dates here. I'm one of the 6-member committee of the Decormier Committee. And I'm the newest member as far as I know. So we have not had, this is the first time 4 of us have been together since COVID. So I have only been to Zoom meetings. Most of you aren't aware of Richard R. Decormier. And we don't know a lot about him. But in 1951, there was a meeting in Rochester, New York, and a group of retired teachers from 6 different zones, Central, Central Western, Eastern, Southern, Southern Eastern, and the Western Zone, they all voted to organize a state group, and they named it after Robert Decormier. They wanted him to be the first president. Thus, here comes the New York State Retired Teachers Association, NYSERTA. And that's when it was founded, 1951. Within a year, so in 1952, 4 more zones joined, Long Island, Northern, North Central, and Northeastern. And Robert had 2 projects in his mind that he wanted to do. He wanted to obtain insurance for retired teachers, and he wanted to provide a retirement home that teachers could afford to stay in. That's what he was looking for. He successfully set up an insurance plan and also saw the completion of a retirement complex in DeWitt, New York. And they called it the York Manor. This complex consisted of a large building, cottages, and a duplex. He worked hard with state and federal legislation as well as friendly services. Now, in 1966, now we're going from 1952, Robert Decormier slipped as he was closing his garage door. The door came down on him, and he died after the sustained injuries that he got from this garage door coming down on him. So he died in 1966. A year later, the members of NYSERTA voted to honor his memory because he was the first president of that group, and they set up an irrevocable trust. Now, this is the first of 3 names. It was first called the Robert R. Decormier Rehabilitation Center Trust. So I'm sure that was part of the DeWitt York Manor. And it was to be governed and overseen by 6 trustees. So we still have 6 trustees today. In 1970, they made an amendment. And in 1971, they adopted a resolution to change the name to the second name, Robert R. Decormier Memorial Fund, whose main purpose was to provide non-contractual aid and relief for needy and retired teachers. In 1995, the York Manor was sold because it was getting too expensive to maintain, and expenses were far outreaching what the income was. To date, the Decormier Fund has sent out contracted over $115,000 to retired teachers. And we have people on monthly financial distributions, and we have people who get just grants. In 2001, the IRS recommended the insertion of the word trust in the name in order to justify it as a tax-free status. So an amendment was passed by the trust. Now the last name and the third name is the Robert R. Decormier Memorial Trust Fund. In 2004, the trustees amended the declaration to provide the trustees a 6-year renewable term, and each term is to be staggered with a different expiration date. So every one of us, our term expires 1 year. So there's always a new member, or at least a new person who's reassigned. Due to the complexities of the original trust and also the various additional amendments, the trustees in 2022 voted to draw up a new 501c3 agreement. So that's what we are, a 501c3, that embodied the interest and the rules of the original and was updated to meet precedent practices and agreements. This arrangement, approved, signed, and dated by the six trustees, replaced the original trust agreement and all amendments previously approved. And that's the history of the DeCormier Committee. That's capital D-E, capital C-O-R-M-I-E-R. And we were just talking, we don't know a lot personally about him, but we're going to try to find that out. And that's the history of the DeCormier Committee.
Thank you very much, Richard. Okay. Rich, as he said, is the newest member on the trust and doing a very good job and certainly gave us a good history of the trust. We're going to ask you, if you have any questions, to hold to the end, because we have presentations. We passed out the information sheets that you have, and Mary Lou will be referring to those. If you think of a question, write it down so you can ask it at the end, okay? Mary Lou?
Thank you.
And you don't have to hold that, he said, unless you want to.
Oh, okay, I'll do this then. I get checks on a regular basis from the zones, from individuals, and also from the retiree organizations, and then I send those checks to an investment company in Rochester called Sage Ruddy, and they invest our money for us. And then once a month, they send me enough money to pay the stipends that we give. We give five people monthly stipends to help them survive because their pensions are very low. Now, they can apply for these stipends, and you have an example on your seat, and they can also apply for special grants, which we'll talk about. In order to get one of these, they have to be a current member, and they have to have been a member for at least 3 years of RENI. They have to be 55 years of age, and they have to have been a school employee, or their husband has to have been, or wife, for a minimum of 15 years. And they have to obviously have financial need or some special circumstance so that we would give them, you know, a grant. And then there's an application, which you also have a sample of on your seat. The first grant was given in September of 2006. And it was to a person who needed a new roof. And I'm just going to read you some of the things that we've covered, and some of these many times.
We, if you don't mind my saying, you do have the application for special grant in front of you. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if you look at that, and I'm happy that you're here. I wish more people were here. But what we are hoping is you will take this back to your zone or your units and tell the people about these special grants. It's actually a very simple form, one page. And on the application, we ask the person, are they members? Are they receiving Medicaid? If they are on Medicaid, we cannot supplement their income. And all the government, or if they're in a nursing home, all the government does is they say, oh, you get $100 from the DeCormier Trust. Well, we send you $100 less, because that has to be classified as income. So a person can be having a monthly stipend for a number of years. If they go on Medicaid, we can no longer give the monthly stipend. But on here, describe the proposed use of the funds, which Mary Lou will give you example of people that have unexpected problems, unexpected expenses, and they say, where is this going to come from? And then why would it be difficult out of your own income assets or family assistance? And they sign it. They send this application to me. We have generally a Zoom conference. We review the case and then respond to the people. We give the grant, and Mary Lou will explain how the checks and so on are sent. But this is the application that she's talking about, the one sheet application, which is called a special grant.
Yeah, and one thing I didn't think, when I get the checks, I send all the information on to Beth, and then she writes all the thank you notes to everyone that has donated money, or we get a lot of memorial gifts for people in the zones or in the organizations that have passed away. And then the kinds of grants, the first grant was for a new roof, and that was in September of 2006, and then I have all the different things, but many of these are in here many times. We did a new furnace for someone back in 2006. Somebody needed coal in 2007, a basement repair, a gas bill, a car repair, insurance, dental bills. We do a lot of dental. monthly stipends, obviously, we give, and I'll talk about them. Home repairs that you need, window replacements, pharmacy bills, vascular groups, replace an auto, a utility bill, rent, electrical system, a medical bill, hearing aids. Again, we do a lot of hearing aids. Community assessment and for a nursing home, a computer replacement, credit card bills when they can't pay the bills. Because sometimes, you know, and even people want a stipend, they may have large medical bills, and then what they do is they borrow on their credit cards, so then they have large credit card bills, large medical bills, and we try to help them get out of that debt. So we do pay credit cards at times, you know, because there they have the interest payments, so sometimes it's best to pay that off so they don't have those large interest payments. We did moving expenses, we did a water conditioner, we paid for insurance at Mutual of Omaha. We did an Albany lift. And the latest thing that we did was generator and storm damage. And I'd like to read you just a few of the notes that we get back. Thank you so much for generously providing the money for our generator. Over the past several months, many homes in our neighborhood lost power. At one point, the power outage lasted for 3 days. It was such a comfort, both physically and emotionally, to have the generator so that we were able to continue our normal routine. We are very grateful. And in this case, the person was in a wheelchair and needed that generator with oxygen. So it was very important that they get the generator. And then this one was from somebody that we did some flood damage. Thank you for helping me during the most distressful time. You're generous and helped alleviate the distress emotionally and financially. And then we have one here. Your financial help will allow me to proceed with my dental plan as soon as my dental office is up and running. Thank you for your generosity. So we do a lot of dental and hearing aids. And it's my hearing aids are working well now. Thank you so much. I'm grateful to have it paid. And then thank you for the wonderful gift and for your caring. Living my meager monthly pension has been a struggle, and you made my life sweeter. I thank you for this. And then we have, it's been so lonely since my border collie died. I used some of my check toward a new puppy. Thank you for your generosity. You know, and thank you for helping me with a new fence. We also did some siding on a house, and one of the members that we did the siding for was an art teacher, and he gave us 20 paintings, which you'll see in the future, you know, which we'll probably raffle off. So, you know, it's really been very good. Yes. Well, the other thing, too, that we become friends with the people, you know, when I write to them monthly, they often call me and they'll call Ann, and I'm sure many of them probably can't contact Beth, but they are lonely, and they do want to talk to somebody, and when they're sick, you know, sometimes, you know, we've had several of the people that we give stipends to that have been ill recently, and during COVID, it's very lonely, and so they do contact us and, you know, just want to talk sometimes and want some help. So, you know, it's really good, I think, it's that what we're doing. So please, you know, go back and tell people that we do have funds available and that we can help them and, you know, spread the word is what we're hoping.
And with the special grant, because it is so short and easy to fill out, people send it in. As soon as they send it in, I send it out to the trustees via email. These two ladies up here have made the rest of us technological. They taught me how to do Zoom conferencing and all. And so now, as soon as they
dental work.
There are two major things, that they can't afford what they need, and they have to make a choice of what to get, so this certainly helps them. And we don't always pay the full thing. Sometimes people ask, you know, my bill's $3,000, I have $1,500, but I just have a trouble with the other, you know, then we give whatever they need or whatever we decide.
And the other way that we get the information out is one of our members decided that a good project would be to send birthday cards. So we do it on a year when Friendly Service doesn't do it. When people are 88 years old, we send them all the information saying, if you need money, let us know, and we send them a birthday card. Dick?
We're a buried treasure sitting here, and I never heard of the Department of Farm or the Department of Committee on Rural has asked if I would like to be on it. So here I am. But we're here, and we're trying to get the word out. Every meeting I go to, I hand out a little yellow pamphlet we got. Put them on chairs, go over to the farm room, and even if you just know somebody, call one of us. We're all in there, our email's in there, and just say, this is Smith. Just mentioning me, she lives too close to me, she needs hearing aids down in order, or she needs this, she needs that, he needs this, he needs that. Just contact one of us. We're buried treasure, we're trying to get unburied. As he said, Captain Kidd or whatever it was. At the end of Long Island.
Me? Okay. I'm addressing the other end of things. The other three have talked about our giving money to people who need it. I'm talking about getting money so that we have the money to give. And De Cormier Fund is a 501c3 charitable trust, so any donations that are made are tax deductible if you choose to take the tax deduction. People make donations, some people, along with units and zones, just automatically make an annual donation. Other people will make donations in memory of someone, especially if a fellow retired teacher passes away. A lot of times we will get donations in memory of those retired teachers. Also, I know Western Zone has a certificate of achievement or whatever we call it. And one of our members made donations in honor of those recipients. So there are various ways that people choose to donate. There's no set amount for a donation. We have received this in this past year, donations ranging from $20 to $12,001. So we will take anything. After a donation is made, I'm the secretary, so I then send a letter to the person who made the donation, and that letter includes the amount of the donation and your check number, so you do have documentation if you choose to take the tax deduction. And also, if you've made the donation in memory of or in honor of someone, and you provide the address or I can track down the address, I send a letter to the honoree or the family of the deceased person, letting them know that you made a donation and what your address is if they wish to contact you. But I do not put the amount of money in that letter, so don't worry about them sitting there thinking, oh, they're only worth that much. thank you. Yes, I just forgot. There is a form on the back of your yellow booklet for making donations. It is not required that you use this form, so if you want to make a donation and can't find it, that's okay, but it does have all the information. It also has Mary Lou's address to send the donation to, although if you can't find this, so you don't have Mary Lou's address, you can send it to Rennie and mark it De Cormier Fund, and they will make sure it's forwarded to Mary Lou. Also, you can get the information from the website, but, and this is something we were talking about, don't type in Rennie if you're looking for the Rennie website, because it takes you to some other Rennie organization. Type in Retired Teachers NY, and it's actually, Retired Educators NY.org. Or if you just start with Retired Educators, it usually fills it in for you. And then you can go to Financial Assistance, and then to the De Cormier donation form. So I think that's all I have to say.
I thought of one other thing. And we are audited. We have an auditing company in Rochester and Albany that goes through our books on a yearly basis to make sure that everything is accurate and that everything is okay. And, you know, each January they go through all of our records, so.
And the other form that we passed out is the application for the monthly stipend. Now, as you can see, this is basically 2 pages long, the third page is for additional information. But on this, I wasn't aware that years ago Social Security was optional. And so some of our retirees, especially the very elderly, didn't realize that their pensions really weren't going to hold on. We have a retiree and a very active, and she was at our meeting, and she's 101 now, right? And when she retired, her pension was $500, and of course it's come up now with COLA and things, but back then $500, you said, oh, I can live the rest of my life on $500 a month. I mean, what more do I need? Well, you know, and probably we're all thinking that too. What I have is enough to live on, and hopefully it will be. And we've learned from other people and from the past, we have, you know, some people have 401s, they have other plans, they have insurances, they have annuities that they really didn't have available years ago. So especially the elderly, we also have people who were had to retire early because of disability, and so their pensions are very low. In one or two of the cases, the parent was sick or the spouse was sick, and the individual had to retire early, therefore they took a much lower pension than it had they continued on. So the application for monthly stipend is where a person may get pension, may even get Social Security, but they can't continue to live. They're always behind, like they're always 150 behind or 200 behind. They just can't afford the basic necessities of life. So for this, we have an application for a monthly stipend, and presently we have five people that receive every month a certain amount of money based on their need. And what is the amount, Mary Lou, presently from what to what?
The lowest one gets $375 a month, and the highest one gets $700.
Okay, so this, and as you can see, this is a very complicated one. If a person has an immediate need, we tell them, you know, you may be eligible for the monthly stipend, but apply monthly grant first, get your money now. This takes quite a while. Plus, it takes quite a while for the person to fill out because we don't just give out the monthly stipend. They have to give us, as you can see, item H, what is the market value of your assets? They have to give us how much they have in cash bank. As a person can have $100,000 sitting in the bank and they're asking for a monthly stipend. So the person has to show all that they have. We look at what their assets. We look at their monthly income, which is number 9 from everything. And the debts, whatever they have, number 12, they give us their monthly expenses. And then we, once they submit this, we review the case, and they have to send us copies of their income tax. We review the case. It probably takes us almost 3-4 weeks sometimes to determine the eligibility. They can request $700, maybe we feel it would be $200, $300, or $400, or they say whatever. So we adjust the amount that we give them. You know, generally we start off, say it's $375 now. Well, perhaps next year we might vote to give everybody a $25 increase for the cost of living. Or that person may all of a sudden have other needs and we may adjust it to $450. Each one is assessed differently. We review this every 2 years so that the person once again has to fill out a form almost like this every 2 years that we see whether or not the need is still as it was before. Is it less or is it more? Because the monthly allotment, every monthly stipend every 2 years can either go down, stay the same, or go up. So, but likewise this, we've received so many wonderful letters and thanking people who really wouldn't be able to exist without this.
Yeah, I wonder on that, would the individual say, like over the course of 2 years then, would they update that information?
Yes.
Yes. To send that back into you for review then?
Yes, every 2 years they have to, it's almost the same form, and they have to send us a copy of their income tax if done. And another item I want to say about the us being a 501c3, probably you're aware of it, but if you have the RMD where you have to take out money from your fund, if you send the, say if I ask my fund for $1,000, they send me a check for $1,000, then I write out the check, but I'm charged tax on that $1,000. If I write the check directly to Robert DeCormier Memorial Trust Fund, there's no tax on it. So it doesn't cost you any tax, and that's not only for the Robert DeCormier, anything. If it's a 501c3, and you can check with your accountant, if the check is sent directly to the institution, you do not pay tax on that amount of money taken out. So actually you're able to give more to the charities that you want to give it to, rather than just receive the money, pay tax on, and then write out your own check to the company. So, and I think that basically covers the basics of the DeCormier Trust, and I'm hoping that you've learned a lot about the trust, and even more so that you will tell other people about it and tell the retirees. It can be any age. There are people that are young that are needy, and we certainly would like to help. And now, if there are any questions, we'd love to entertain them.
Can I just say one quick thing?
Yes. Question? We have a wonderful treasurer who orders the cards, orders the stamps, has all the zones, and this is Mary Lou, and she brought the boxes today. She gives them to us. And so every person that's 88 years old that is a member of RENI will get a card. And that's many times the age where people all of a sudden need hearing aids, they need dental work, and so we reinforce the idea about the money being available.
And I buy them in quantities when they're on sale.
Another question? Well, you know, friendly service, at least in Western Zone, we do 80, 85, 90, 95 and up for birthday cards.
So we thought, well, since they get it at 85, but you don't mention anything about financial aid, and they get a card at 90, so 88, you know, it's the sort of the middle point, and then Mary Lou does the insert that we put in explaining on one simple sheet that it's not complicated, just that money is available and what they should do if they need it. And go ahead.
No, because we do it in, at Central Zone, we do every year. Mm-hmm. And we have some units that do it at 80, and so until they transition, they're going to get one every year. Oh. There's some units that don't start until we get 90.
Now, what do you do every year? From what age?
Send them a birthday. At what time, how many people are you serving with the special grant or the stipend?
Presently, we have 5 monthly stipends. The number has decreased significantly.
Okay, I missed that, but now I remember you said
yeah, 5 monthly stipends. And I was a math teacher, but Beth always finds my math errors. okay, but anyway, for the monthly stipends, we used to give a lot of monthly stipends. The requests got less, and so at this point, I think it's appropriate to mention Imogene McKendrick was a de Cormier trustee for 22 years, and she just resigned this year. Her husband was very ill, and she took care of him. And sad to say, her husband passed away about a week and a half ago. And Imogene gave so much of herself, time and all. And as the monthly stipend requests were becoming less, Imogene is the one who said, you know, we should be using this money for something special. And that was back in 2006. And she actually began the, suggested it, and then we voted on and took that on. We have given now, and Beth helped me on this, and Dick, I gave you that, but I don't remember what it was. We have given in special grants over $112,000 in special grants since 2006. And, you know, some years there's more, some there's less. 20 seemed like in 2020, I was surprised, but we had quite a few requests in 2020, more than in the previous.
I think because of COVID, a lot of things went up in price, and there were more needs. They were charging things to be delivered to the house, their food and all, and they started to run out of money. So there were more requests, I think, then when COVID started, and you know, than we've had now. Then they seem to be slowing down now, the requests, but you know, we gave them a lot of money at that point to help get through what was happening.
We had one more question in the back.
Yeah, well, I had two things.
Go on.
I was going to mention Imogene, but there will be money coming from our zone and several members of our zone in Wally's memory. But I've given them a form, and I think I have the right address in it so that it'll come to Mary Lou. But the other one is, I want to say, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, we had somebody speak about the DeCormier. And it was, I believe, a grandson.
Yes. Is it a grandson, nephew? I was talking about that this morning.
Right.
I said 4 years ago, maybe it was 8 years ago.
Right.
Time goes like, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
But it might be a good, you know, to go back to our records and see if we can find who it is and have him, you know, maybe has more information or something that we would like, because he was really a great speaker.
Yes.
Hair and always very neat and trim, and she sat in
registration. Okay, well, you know, if there are no more, thank you so much. I just want to say, when they called and asked, would we do the presentation, I was delighted, because I have to very honestly say, and I really mean this, I have the best group of trustees anybody could ever have. No matter what I ask, if I have to double check on something, I email Beth and I ask her, what do you think, or what this, what that, they put their input in so much. So, as I told the committee that asked me, I said, of course we'll present it. My trustees will present it. And folks, I got to tell you, you did a great job. And thank you very much to both of you. And thank you also for attending. I wish more had come, but you take out what you heard today and pass it on, okay, because it's worth a lot to other people. And thank you for having us. Thank you for coming.